Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, now celebrating their 125th anniversary. From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. Was there a teacher who changed your life? On this week's show, we'll talk with both students and teachers who influenced each other's lives, in cooking school, of course. Chef Jacquy Pfeiffer, Dean of the French Pastry School at Kennedy King College in Chicago, inspires students every day with his enduring dedication to sharing his master pastry skills while continuing to fine-tune them. We'll talk with Jacquy and one of his students, our very own Nola Pie Guy, Nate Winner. And with cooking, a lot of learning doesn't just happen in school, but in working kitchens everywhere. Syrena Johnson was the recipient of John Besh's first Chef's Move scholarship. Now, 3 years later, we'll catch up with Syrena to learn how her education has continued after Culinary Academy. There's lots of delicious lessons to be learned on this week's Louisiana Eats. For 20 years, Chef Jacquy Pfeiffer has served as the academic dean at the French Pastry School in Chicago. His fame, however, extends far beyond this title. Chef Jacquy has had a long career working for world-renowned kitchens across the globe and hit a high point when he received the Meilleur Ouvrier de France Award, chronicled in the 2009 documentary Kings of Pastry. Today, Chef Jacquy shares with us some tips from his new book, The Art of French Pastry, and tells how he began his journey as an apprentice at the age of 15.
For me, that was a great idea at the time. At the age of 15, I said, you know, I don't want to continue high school, and they allow you to do that in Europe. They allow you to join a trade. You could become a carpenter, you could become a mechanic, a chef, a hairdresser, a florist, you name it. And you go into an apprenticeship, which means you have to work for a master carpenter, master pastry chef, for 2 years. You go to school once a week. And at the end of the 2 years of pretty much slavery, we could call it, you go through an exam. If you pass, then you are a pastry cook. If you fail, you go for another year of apprenticeship, which is definitely great motivation to do well. My dad was looking out for me to find somebody who would really teach me well. So he asked around, and people told him, Mr. Jean Claus in Strasbourg, he's very strict and he will teach your son well. I had no idea that this guy was much more than strict. And at the age of 15, when you go from having a pretty much a life where you just think about playing soccer and just running around, on the hills, and suddenly from one day to another, you have to produce pastries for 12 hours a day for a guy who's screaming at you. It's very, very brutal, but it definitely changed my life.
All of this, I imagine, has left you with some scars that are like badges of honor.
There's physical scars and there's emotional scars that are still there. But you know what? After those 2 years of apprenticeship, I graduated, and at the age of 17, I was really not afraid of many things anymore. And also, I grew up a lot in 2 years, and then I earned a living already at the age of 17. I worked in Borneo, on the island of Borneo, for the Sultan of Brunei. I became his pastry chef, and there it was doing crazy things like doing events for 10,000 people in the jungle. Also worked in Saudi Arabia. We were servicing the royal family. I worked in Hong Kong, which is a magical place, and all those places I could work there without being afraid because of my apprenticeship.
Chef Jacquy's journey eventually brought him to Lyon in 2007, where he competed for France's most prestigious pastry award, the Meilleur Ouvrier de France, awarded by none other than France's president of that time, Nicolas Sarkozy.
It's, I wish I could compare it to the Olympics. Maybe it's a little bit like the Olympics, where you go to another country and to compete in a specialty. And that competition for me was pastry, and I was competing together with 16 French pastry chefs. I say together because it's not a question of first place, second, and third. It's actually also an exam. So if you score enough points, you get the title of Meilleur Ouvrier de France. But the most important thing is to go through the process and force yourself to take yourself out of your comfort zone, go to another country where they have different power, different ingredients, and you try to duplicate the things that you were practicing on for 2 years in the U.S. So that's what it's all about, and it's just pushing yourself to another level.
One of the things that is described in this contest is that, as I understand it, what you must do is come up with a complete buffet presentation suitable for a wedding, and that what you came up with featured as many as 40 different recipes on that one table. What did you do? What did you come up with?
Well, there is some tricky things that were required. 5 different types of cream puffs. That means 5 different flavors, right? The tricky part is that a cream puff is so simple, but actually they're expecting you to take that cream puff to another level. This is where you don't know how far should you go. Should you go crazy? If you go too crazy, the old-timer judges might get upset. If you go not crazy enough, they'll call you boring and outdated. So for the cream puffs, I had a chocolate and cardamom eclair. Under the eclair, there was a little base made out of a nougatine with different nuts and sesame seeds. I have another cream puff that was filled with an exotic cream. So that's banana, mango, passion fruit. Underneath, there was a disc of coconut cookie, very, very thin, paper thin. And then I had another one that was a hazelnut puff that was covered with hazelnut and sugar. And underneath, there was actually a cookie that looked like a little crown. And in the middle, there was some candied orange jam. So that's just to describe 3 of the cream puffs. And that's right there, that's maybe 9 recipes. You know, there's another 30-some recipes, right? And that's what it's also about. When you compete like this, you don't have a book next to you with, oh, put this first and this after simmer for 20 minutes. It should all be in your head. So you just put the ingredients on your table, you do it, clean your dishes, make another recipe.
Out of everything that you created, what do you think was the one that made people step back and go, my?
Well, I created an entire system, kind of like a MacGyver system, to make cream puffs that stay round in a convection oven. Convection ovens have a fan that blows really, really strongly on the cream puffs. And when this happens, the cream puff kind of like cracks open, explodes. And I just created a system with like refractory stones on all sides of the oven. And the judges were really impressed that I schlepped all this from the U.S. to over there. But again, it's always trying to think out of the box.
So who won?
You have to watch the documentary.
But we all know that you received the title. That's for certain.
We don't know that.
I'd like to know how that international film exposure changed your life. Did it change in any way after that?
Yeah, you know, it's we get a lot of people contacting the French Pastry School, and they are interested in becoming a pastry chef. And to this day, I have people who tell me, you know, I am joining the field of pastry because of the film. So mission accomplished, you know, if if this is what I wanted, and it is what I wanted, it's mission accomplished.
Chef Jacquy went on to explain his teaching process and some tips and techniques from his new book, The Art of French Pastry, that's an entire pastry course in itself.
Every 6 months, I welcome 108 students or so at the French Pastry School in Chicago, and the first day of class, we tell them that they will not be able to use their cups and teaspoons and tablespoons. So I usually pick a person who seems really upset, and I ask her to come at the chef's demonstration table, and I ask this person to measure a cup of flour. And then once she does this, I say, okay, now we'll put it on the scale. And then I write how many grams it made. Then I say, okay, do it again. She does it again, or he does it again. And every cup actually has a different weight. Now imagine if you make a recipe or, I don't know, a pound cake. You need 10 cups of sugar, 20 cups of flour, this, that. You see the amount of errors that could happen. Then after that, you have the liquid measurement. Same thing. If you fill it more, if you fill it less, you don't hold it straight. And then how do you measure eggs and things like this? If you look at whole eggs visually, if you have a sharp eye, you will see maybe that some of them are small, some of them are medium, some of them are large. If you have small eggs, you have 450 grams, which is exactly 1 pound, or 650 grams, which is a pound and a half. Your recipe is going to fail. So we prove it to our students that if you actually just use one piece of equipment, which is one scale, that's all you need to do. You don't need to rely on 5-6 pieces of equipment. It's just to be more precise.
Another thing, it's done when it's done. Why was that important?
The book was written after 20 years of teaching. The French Pastry School is 20 years this year. And a lot of things in this book are because I saw mistakes that were happening every 6 months when we have new students. And students, for some reason, think that if the timer goes off, the product is ready. And I had a student, she was so timer crazy that I told her, bake this at 350 for 20 minutes. So she set the timer for 20 minutes, and then the timer went off. And she's like, chef, the timer went off, the product is ready. I said, all right. And then she went in the oven, took the product out, put it on her table, and I said, well, you just forget one thing. And she's like, what? You forgot to turn on the oven. The oven was not on. So, but when the timer goes off, it does not mean that the product is done. It means that you have to go and check. You would call it the first check.
Last question for you, chef.
Yes.
Here you are, one of the greatest pastry chefs undeniably in the world. And I'm curious if even today, is there any particular baking process that you still find challenging or that you take a little breath before you get started on?
All of them. Because it never ends. I have only my brain to put all the knowledge that can be learned and try to make sense of it, because I'm just a baker, a pastry chef, right? I was not trained to be a food scientist, to be an artist and all this. So there's always so much that can be learned about food science, about artistry, about business, I don't know. On the way here in my airplane, I was reading a book about understanding baking, because there's always some facts that you didn't know about, and you're like, oh, that's why this is happening, that's why that's happening. So it's also beautiful that, you know, you are in a profession that will always have something to give you. There's always something you can research. It's never a profession where you can say, oh, pastry, I've done it. I've been there, done that.
Well, that's the challenge and that's the fun.
Yes.
Thank you so much for speaking with us on Louisiana Eats.
Thank you so much. It was really a lot of fun.
Chef Jacquy Pfeiffer in his new book, The Art of French Pastry. To be honest, I'm more of a cook than a baker. But when I studied with French cooking teacher Madeline Kamen, she taught me how to make a flawless butter crust in classic French style. A lot of home bakers make their crust in a food processor, but I enjoy the whole process of making mine by hand. Mix 1/8 teaspoon of salt into 1.5 cups of all-purpose flour. Then, cut very cold butter into tablespoon-sized slices. It always amused me that Madeline insisted on using 9 tablespoons of butter in her pastry crust recipe when there are only 8 tablespoons in American sticks of butter. But her recipe is perfect, so don't you skimp on that extra tablespoon. Temperature is everything when making a good crust, so a cold granite countertop or a marble slab are perfect surfaces for crust making. Using just your fingertips, work each tablespoon of butter into the flour, creating small pea-sized balls. Then, make a well in the center of your flour and butter mixture and add ice-cold water by the tablespoon, quickly pushing the flour with your fingertips from the outside in until there's just enough liquid for your crust to stick together. Gather the pastry crust into a ball, wrap it in plastic, and let it rest in your refrigerator for at least 1/2 hour before rolling it out. Lightly flour your cold surface and your rolling pin, then roll the crust into a thickness of about 1/8 inch. If you see streaks of butter in the crust, it's sure to be flaky and lovely. During the baking process, those butter streaks will puff up, creating the flaky layers that make a pie or tart crust perfect. One last tip, roll the crust up on your rolling pin to easily unroll it onto the pie tin. I'm Poppy Tooker, and Madeline Kamen's recipe makes a perfect pie crust every time. When we come back from a short break, Nate Winter, the Nola Pie Guy, joins us with memories of his time with Jacquy Pfeiffer at the French Pastry School in Chicago. Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. Nate Winter is also known as the Nola Pie Guy. Nate's passion for pie making began when he studied pastry at the French Pastry School in Chicago under the tutelage of Chef Jacquy Pfeiffer. While he was there, Nate learned that it takes more than technical knowledge to become a good chef. Nate's here to discuss his time as a student, the lessons he learned in school, and what he's done since graduation to pursue his dreams. Nate, welcome to Louisiana Eats.
Thanks for having me, Poppy.
You actually studied at the French Pastry School with the pastry great, Jacquy Pfeiffer. What was that like?
It was awe-inspiring. To watch a master at work of that level on a daily basis was remarkable. It's something you don't really get a chance to do in many careers. It was an opportunity every day to see a master in his element, practicing his craft, and then more importantly for me, sharing it with everybody else. And it just came through in everything he did. The love, the art, the history, everything really came through in the product. Everything was on point all the time. You could tell he was a man doing what he loves every day of his life.
Well, describe a typical day there at school.
Absolutely. So a typical day, you arrive, you go into the locker room, you change into your chef whites, and you go up to class. Now, most days will start with the chef doing a demo. So he's going to have on the board written what you're going to make that day. He's going to demo a couple of them. We'll do a little Q&A back and forth. You know, we're students. We're there to learn. We have a lot of questions. A lot of this stuff we're seeing for the very first time. So they demo the recipe. They answer questions. They go over everything. And then they set us free back to our tables to work and make the recipes with our partners. And then they'll just kind of walk around and coach us through it, correct any of our mistakes, let us make a few and use them as kind of learning opportunities for the whole class throughout the day.
Who were the other students who were in the program with you, and why were they there?
I actually went right after undergrad, so I was about 22 years old when I was in the school. The average age of the student body when I was there was about 28 to 30.
Really?
So you had a lot of career changers, a lot of people who had done their, you know, typical first career. They went to college, they got maybe a desk job, they found success but weren't really excited on a day-to-day with what they were doing, and had always wanted to get into pastry. And the French Pastry School has a great reputation, so they got a lot of those people that were career changers looking to try something new.
You know, I'm really curious. The people who are going to the French Pastry School, what are their expectations going in? You know, I think a lot of people go off to culinary school with some unrealistic expectations.
So when you arrive in Chicago to go to the pastry school, before you even step foot in a kitchen, you have 1 week of more or less lectures. You learn food safety, some basic knife skills, but there are also some lectures on the reality of life in the kitchen. They tell you there very clearly that when you leave here, you are not an executive pastry chef. You are not just going to walk into the kitchen of your choosing and run the show, unless it is your kitchen and you've bought it and paid for it, then have at it. But they're very clear that a chef is an ongoing thing. The founder, Jacquy Pfeiffer and Sebastian Canone, are the first to tell you that they practice every day. It's an ongoing art and craft. There's always something to learn and always something to master. You're never done. So the certificate you get at the end of the 6 months doesn't mean you're a master French pastry chef. It's not the end of your education. It's just the foundation.
Was staging part of your experience there?
Absolutely. Staging was a very important part of my experience, and one that I recommend everybody do, regardless of whether or not they're in school. It's just a great way to learn a lot of different things.
Well, you know, before we continue that conversation, perhaps you better explain what it means to do a stage.
So staging is basically usually a 1 to 2 day trial where I will go into someone else's kitchen and work for free. A lot of operations and restaurants and hotel kitchens will have stages for people that when they have a position open and they have a bunch of interested candidates, you know, they'll kind of weed through them and then select a few that they're interested in pursuing, and they'll invite those candidates to come stage. So you'll go and work in their kitchen for a day or two. And it's a great way to kind of get a feel for the kitchen on both ends. Me as someone who's interested in working there, and them as someone who's willing to hire and train a new person, they get to see, okay, does this person have the energy to keep up? Are they going to contribute? Are they going to make my kitchen better at the end of the day? Me as a potential hire can go and see, do I like the energy of this kitchen? Do I like the pace? Is it a clean kitchen? And a stage, that's just kind of one way to skin a cat. A lot of people get into pastry a lot of different ways. Some will go to school. Some will start working in kitchens on the weekends, doing stages, working for free, and just kind of work their way up. I have some friends who never went to pastry school, but they're phenomenal. They're some of the best pastry chefs you're ever going to meet. Just because you go to school, you're not a pastry chef. Mm-hmm. It's just the foundation. It's there to teach you the fundamentals, to expose you to all the possibilities. But it's up to you as an individual to really push yourself to master that craft.
You graduate from the French Pastry School, and you know now how to make all sorts of elaborate baked goods. You can do sponge sugar. You can make candy. Nate, why pie?
Because there is sophistication and simplicity. One thing they're great about teaching you at the pastry school is there's always going to be trends and there's always going to be fads. But if you know the fundamentals and the basics and you can do them well, you're doing it better than 99% of the people out there. So I love pies. Pies are what I grew up on. You know, it's just that nostalgic, down-home, rustic simplicity. But to do it well isn't easy. You know, there's a difference. Simple does not equate to easy. You can do simple things, but doing them extremely well takes as much time and effort as the next thing. So that's what I was. It was combining all these techniques and kind of a learning style and dedication to perfection and to learning the basics and doing them extremely well and consistently well, and applying that to what I knew and loved from back home, which is Southern pies.
Southern pies. And what sort of pies do you make that reflect in some way on this French culinary background that you've got?
Right. So your product is going to be a direct reflection of the time and effort you put into it and the ingredients you use. So here in New Orleans, we're lucky to have a very warm climate, which is great for growing all this beautiful produce just about year-round. I mean, as early as the week before Thanksgiving, I've had access to ponchatoula strawberries, and they're fantastic. The early crops are really sweet. You still get a few cold snaps here and there, which the ones that survive it come out a little bit sweeter because of it.
Yeah.
And the citrus season is beautiful, so it's taking that appreciation for good, fresh, local ingredients and putting that in pies. And we've got boatloads of it here in New Orleans. So another thing they teach you when composing a dessert, you know, pastry is an art, and all arts have elements to it. So how can I compose a piece of art on the plate with something as simple as pie? Well, you do it with textures. You do it with flavors. You do it with colors. You have this whole kind of reservoir of different things you can pull from. So why not use a crumbly graham cracker crust and a silky smooth filling and then a really light, airy whipped topping? And then to finish it off, just put a little sprinkle of some oven-dried streusel to give it a nice little crunch. All those different things I just described are also opportunities for new flavor profiles. Maybe the crust is a little salty. Maybe the whipped cream is really sweet. Maybe the filling is seasonal fruit that's a nice balance of sour and sweet. It's just a beautiful way to play with a lot of different textures and flavor profiles.
Well, now that you're working full-time in your own baking business, looking back on your time in school, what was the most valuable lesson you learned in school?
It's just the learning style. It's something where, and I think it holds true for all things in life, you've always got to push yourself. You can never be complacent, because that's when you slip up, that's when you lose ground, that's when you experience true failure, is when you give up pushing yourself and learning new things. And to see the founders of the school, who are literally some of the best in the world at what they do, getting to school before any student, before majority of people, and practicing in their own kitchens.
Wow.
And then staying late and practicing. There's a beautiful documentary called The Kings of Pastry.
Yes.
Starring Jacquy Pfeiffer, who's one of the co-founders. And I was actually a student when they were filming that.
Really?
And it follows Jacquy as he competes for his MOF, which is a very prestigious title given to masters of their craft in France. And the amount of time and dedication he put into training for that competition is just awe-inspiring. It was a really beautiful thing to get to see firsthand. I'm very fortunate for having been there.
Well, he's a pretty awe-inspiring fella himself.
Exactly.
He really is. I was thrilled to get to meet him. And his book, now that's something else too.
It's fantastic.
Thank you so much for taking the time out of that busy business work day to visit with us here on Louisiana Eats.
Poppy, it's always a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Nate Winner, the Nola Pie Guy. Today's widespread farm-to-fork effort has made us all care more about where our food comes from and how it's grown. This movement really began as a delicious revolution launched by Alice Waters in her Berkeley restaurant, Chez Panisse. As Alice worked to re-educate American palates, she came to realize that to effect real and permanent change, the taste buds of our country's children needed to be educated too. In 1994, Alice founded the Edible Schoolyard at Berkeley's Martin Luther King Jr. Middle School. At the Edible Schoolyard, the lessons of the garden permeate the entire curriculum. When Katrina's floodwaters receded, Alice found a fertile ground for expanding her Berkeley program right here in New Orleans at the Samuel J. Green Charter School. That first New Orleans Edible Schoolyard was such a resounding success that the First Line Charter School Group has expanded the program, including gardens and teaching kitchens, in now a total of 5 schools across the New Orleans area. Here's how it all began.
After we met at the Smithsonian Folk Festival on the National Mall there in Washington, with a lot of senators and congressmen and important people in terms of food, and we were just brainstorming about important places to demonstrate the principles of the Edible Schoolyard, our project here in Berkeley. And the idea, the first idea, of course, was New Orleans. And after Katrina, everybody was trying to imagine what the answer could be. And all of this came together in a beautiful way with friends and friends of friends and philanthropists. And that's why we created the Edible Schoolyard in that place.
Would you explain to our listeners what a day might be like for children in the Edible Schoolyard?
Well, I see that that eating and learning about food and how to take care of the environment are all connected with all the subjects in the school. So you might be in an art class in the morning, and it might take place out in the garden, and so that you're drawing the plants in front of you and actually understanding something about the growing of those plants or even the taste of those plants. It might be a strawberry plant, and you get to pick the strawberry after you draw the picture.
School lunch plays such an important part in every child's day, and I know this is a topic that you are particularly passionate about. Would you share your vision about what lunch should be like for all school children?
Well, I have a very a complete and idealistic vision for what I would like, because it's so important that we feed every child. We need to feed them a wholesome and delicious school lunch, and they shouldn't have to pay for it. It should be an experience that is beautiful and communicative and nourishing in the deepest level. So that's what I'm thinking about. I'm thinking about pure food, food that is sustainably raised, bought locally, supporting the agriculture of the place nearby the school. And that's it. There's not a way to serve children sort of better lunches. It's either really good or it's not. And I'm interested in the former.
Well, I'm very enamored by the way that you even weave the dining culture into the school experience.
Well, it's a place. The table has always been a place where we gather and talk with our family and our friends, and punctuate the day with something tasty. And it seems so important there in New Orleans because you have the richest gastronomy in this country. And children are losing that understanding of food and how important it is in everyone's daily life. And that when you're eating on the run, instead of sitting at the table, you're really missing out on not only something that's likely to be nourishing, but something that is very culturally rich and meaningful to you.
Well, we are several years into our Edible Schoolyard New Orleans now. You must be pretty pleased with what you see here, huh?
Well, I'm very excited that the farmers market right there in New Orleans is a part of the sort of leadership team that is working at the school. So you're constantly bringing in those foodstuffs and not only planting the seeds in the actual garden of the school, but meeting the producers that come to the farmers market. And ultimately, it would be a dream to buy all of the food from Louisiana.
Wouldn't that be great?
Wouldn't it be fantastic?
It would
give
be.
Give the money for the school lunches back to those farmers and ranchers and suppliers that really care about the children in the school.
Alice, that's why I love you. You're always such a visionary dreamer. Alice, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day to chat with us. And please, let's rendezvous in the garden again soon.
Indeed, indeed.
Alice Waters, founder of the Edible Schoolyard and advocate for the health of our nation's children. Which is the better choice in baking, salted or unsalted butter? We'll be right back with the answer to that important question. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. Which is a better choice for baking, salted or unsalted butter? Unequivocally, the answer is unsalted. That's the only way to control the salt level in your pastry. Also, salt acts as a preservative in butter, so unsalted is likely to be a fresher product. Unsalted butter stays fresh in the fridge for only about a month. Salted lasts up to 3 months. How can you tell if your butter's too old? Cut a slice to see if the color is uniform. If the outside is darker than the inside, it's past its time, so toss it out. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Faithful listeners to Louisiana Eats might remember meeting Syrena Johnson when she became the first recipient of the Chef's Move Scholarship, a program started by John Besh and Bride Mayer that fosters the development of young African-American chefs from the greater New Orleans area.
Pretty much, I'm an uptown girl. Born and raised in New Orleans, 21 years. The only year that I left was for the hurricane, and that was to live in Texas, and then we immediately came back. I've been working since I was 16 years old. As soon as I came back from the hurricane, I wanted to work. I wanted to make my own money. I wanted to do things for myself. So I got a job. I worked at McDonald's, my first job, and progressed up from there to start working at August. I've grew up and went to some of the schools that people probably frowned upon, and I grew up with some of the people that right now they're not doing nothing with themselves. So to see me doing this is really like an eye opener for them. It's making them want to do something better with themselves.
Shortly after her first interview, Syrena spent a year at the French Culinary Institute in New York learning her trade. Her mentorship included media training and staging at some of New York's finest dining establishments. Syrena's back in New Orleans and joins us today to recap her time in New York and discuss how her mentorship continues right here at home. So, Syrena, welcome back to Louisiana Eats.
Thank you for having me, Poppy.
You get up there and you start classes. What was the biggest challenge in New York initially?
Just getting used to the fact that I was going to be somewhere out of my element for 9 months away from my family, really not knowing what I was getting into, but knowing that it was going to better me. So just really getting used to my element. New York was a great place. I have nothing bad to say about New York. I feel like it's sort of similar to New Orleans. We have a lot of similarities, but it's a real cool place. My school was awesome. Everyone in it was awesome. I would never trade anything that I took from that school or replace anybody that I met or any of my instructors.
Who were your favorite teachers at the French Culinary Institute? Who really stands out as somebody who made a difference for you?
Chef Veronica and Chef X. Chef X was like a real stern teacher. One of the first questions that they ask you in school is like, what are your connections or have you ever worked in restaurants before? And you know me, I put Chef John Besh, and he was, from then, he was just like, oh, you know, you work at this place, and you work at this place that on menu that you know this or that you know that. So, I mean, he kind of was hard on me, but I kind of needed that too to kind of snap me back into reality. Like, I do know these people, but just because I know them doesn't mean anything unless I could put the skill to back it up too. So, and Chef V was just always on me, just always telling me, you know, stick to what you know, stay organized, always stay true to yourself. And I ran into hard times, and they picked me up there and just taught me everything that I needed to know to get me built up to where I'm at now. And I appreciate all of it.
Out of everything that you acquired, what did you learn that you thought, I don't know if I'm going to get this one done?
I just think, as a cook, I just think it's building up your confidence, like believing in yourself. That's what it is for me, because I'm the hardest person on myself. I'm always striving to do the best. I will always want to do the best and always look to receive the best from me. So I'm my hardest critic. It was overcoming my battles with myself and being a confident cook and knowing that, you know, I can execute this. I can do this. I don't have to think too much on things because I know that I can do this. If I just have faith in myself and believe in myself, I can do it.
Well, this program involved a lot more than just culinary school. Tell me about the media training.
They actually set you up with media training with the fabulous, wonderful Melissa Harris Perry. And it's just awesome. They just tell you the do's and the don'ts on social media, what to say, what not to say, how to carry yourself professional. I got to get my training right around the time Anthony Weiner was very popular in news feeds. So they, of course, they threw that scenario to me. But I mean, it's all things that we probably know too, but just to refresh your memory. I tell all the new candidates, everybody who asks me for advice when they ask me, I just say, just be yourself. Just let your personality pop. Just be calm and everything will be cool.
So then you completed the program and you came back to New Orleans because that's part of the deal, right? Because John has set out to make sure that we have classically trained African-American native New Orleanians who are intended to become an integral part of our own culinary scene here. So where have you been cooking since you came back?
Since I came back, you know, Chef has an internship that you have to do. I think it's at least 2 or 4 weeks in his restaurants, and you can go on a tour and take it around any one of his restaurants. But I stayed at August for a little bit, and then I finished the duration of my tour at Dominica with Chef Alain. So after that, I went, did a tour at Bayona. I chilled with Chef Susan Spicer.
Oh my goodness gracious. How was that?
Chef is, she's a cool person. Unlike,
but she's tough, man.
She's tough. Unlike any chef I ever met, she's tough, but she's not that tough. Like, she's real cool. Like, she won't ever get out of the box and crazy, but you know when she says something, she means it.
She runs a tight ship.
Yeah, she does. And when whatever she likes. And you know it because she's going to drill it in you. There's certain things that I learned from her that will always stay with me, too. Just little things that you have in the kitchen to just really control you. I was like, Chef, what school did you go to? And she was like, the School of Hard Knocks. And I was okay.
She did. All right. That was apprenticeship the whole way through for Susan.
She'll call you out. Uh-huh. Like, she knows about you. I know you better than this. And I know you wouldn't do that. Come on.
That was a fantastic place to work. So it's so fascinating that even though you finished your formal training in 2012, you're learning every day still.
Yep. I still visit Miss Chase whenever I just want to, like, talk about something or just, like, hear some good inspirational talk with her. I just go over there. Any type of thing that I'm feeling, like if I feel like I want to do this or any type of dream that I'm feeling, I will go over there and just really talk to her. I can come up and say, I want to make a water lemonade stand. And she said, girl, you know you got to do it. Go ahead and do it. Ain't nobody else doing it. Do it. You know you can do it. So that's who I always go to whenever I just really want to talk to someone. She's always good for that. And I'm glad that I met all these wonderful, legendary people that I can sit down and get advice from and can really talk to in this field that I'm working in.
So now you're at Cafe Adelaide, which yep. is, of course, part of the Brennan family mm-hmm. system. How long are you resting in one spot these days?
I want to rest in this spot for a while because I don't really want to bounce around like that. I want to kind of get into home and kind of get a feel for it and learn as much as possible. But at the same time, I do want to progress in my career. I want to have a title. I want to get up there. So I'll see how good Adelaide treats me and how much I learn from there. Because I always say if nobody ever gives me a title, I'm just going to go out and take it myself.
Like, you're just going to give yourself a title.
If I don't become a chef or a sous chef in big name restaurants, then I'm going to just go out and I'm going to make my own thing and I'm going to be my own boss.
Syrena, I'm constantly amazed by how few women end up making it and sticking it in the restaurant business, just sticking at it. Are you surrounded by men in these kitchens?
Oh, yeah. Right now, I'm currently the only girl at Cafe Adelaide working around a bunch of guys. It's not typical for you to have that. I mean, it's mostly a guy's kitchen in there. But when you get a girl who comes in and knows what she's doing, you kind of make the guys nervous for a minute. So that's always cool, too. And I have cool mentors within the best organization, like Chef Jacquy and Chef Kelly at August, who were really, like, good role models to me. Chef Lisa at Dominica, who go to work all the time, and they are bomb at what they do. They're, like, the best at what they do, and no guy could even perform against them. So all those inspirations, along with Chef Susan Spicer and Miss Leah Chase, like, they all give me inspiration to that. Like, I know I don't have any worries in the kitchen with a whole bunch of men.
Well, you are an inspiration to all of us, and I am so grateful that you came to spend this time with us today. Thank you, Syrena.
Thank you, Bobby.
New Orleans' own rising chef, Syrena Johnson. This week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Next week, Seafood Authority Paul Greenberg uncovers fraud in our food system.
Take your Gulf red snapper, for example. So much seafood fraud goes on around that fish. You know, so many different species get swapped, and sometimes tilapia even gets swapped in for red snapper. So my argument is we got to re-educate our palates. We have to get this fine scale tasting back. And with that, you know, an interconnection with our own environment.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Dickie Brennan and Company and Linda Green, the Yakima and Lady Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Thanks to executive producer Thomas Walsh and sound engineer Joe Schreiner. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.